So, the next person who's going to speak for this conference, we have the pleasure to have here Mr. Edwin Glasgow, CBE, QC Senior Counsel and Chairman of the Singapore International Mediation Center. The Singapore International Mediation Center has worked significantly to create the Florence International Mediation Center. So we have to thank Mr. Glasgow for his cooperation. And the second thing I need to say is that he knew only yesterday to do this talk because there was someone else supposed to be on the program, Mr. Kehinde Aina, who could not come. So this is the reason he's going to have, of course, a significant talk, but it's different from the one that was programmed. So please, I invite Mr. Edwin Glasgow to come here.
Signore e signori, ospiti illustri, grazie molto per il benvenuto e grazie mille per avermi permesso di parlare in inglese. It was kind of her to say that I was only asked yesterday to do it in view of my very limited abilities and my equally limited time for preparation. My talk will be short and probably talk closer to what I hope people wouldn't be able to hear. I was going to say my talk was going to be short and probably incomprehensible, but at least you can take comfort for the fact that if I were polite enough to talk to you in Italian, it would be even shorter and totally incomprehensible. The perspicacious among you may have noticed that I am not young and charismatic and Nigerian. I'm afraid I fail on all three counts. I'm sorry that you're deprived of Kenny talking to you because he is truly probably the best mediator in Africa, one of the best in the world, and an inspirational mediator. And to stand in his shoes is not easy. It's not easy for anybody like me to stand in front in a palace like this, which does not much remind me of my own home, in front of a distinguished audience. It's a little intimidating, I can assure you. You'll forgive me that I am not, in the time that I've had available, going to attempt to make an academic address to you, because my interest in what I want to talk about is not remotely academic. I have a passionate concern for what we're here talking about today, and rather than speak to you from badly conceived notes, I would like to speak to you informally from the heart because I care about it very much. The first thing that I want to do is to repeat the congratulations that have already been expressed better than I could in both languages to the courage and inspiration of the Florence International Chamber of Commerce. What they have done is hugely brave and I think socially and commercially incredibly important. And we at the Singapore International Mediation Center, and I know the American Arbitration Association and the International Center for Dispute Resolution are hugely proud to be associated with that effort. It is not surprising that it comes from this city, which has taught us so much over so many centuries. Some of it, perhaps, a veil might be drawn over when I think back that a great deal of our commercial life is based in its origins in this city, and we're conscious of that. It's also, of course, true to say that much of our international banking started its life here, and probably even the Medicis might be a little ashamed of what it has become today, but I'm absolutely certain that you'll do considerably better at mediation than the rest of the world has done with international banking. I think that the new mediation chamber is also entitled to be hugely proud of what they've done. The inspiration in setting that up, and may I without, it's always invidious to refer to individuals, but in watching with respect and admiration from afar, we have admired hugely the work that Brunella Talli, Chiara Condini, and Elisa Vestri particularly have done. Herculean efforts against considerable obstacles to set this up. Nobody sets up an international mediation center, indeed nobody becomes a mediator or any kind of mediation center, in thinking that you're going to become either popular or wealthy, because you will be neither. Mediators, on the whole, are sometimes liked and admired by their clients, but by precious few other people. And if anybody has the ambition of thinking that you're going to be internationally popular, or as I say, make a huge amount of money out of it, you're misconceived. We teach our children in England, and I'm aware because I've also seen it in translation, when they come to us for entertainment, we teach them about the three bears, and you'll know the story well. I think that litigants sometimes need to be taught about the three bewares before they contemplate mediation. I think that they should be told to beware lawyers, beware mediators, and beware converts. I take them in reverse order. Nothing is more embarrassing or annoying than the recent convert. We all know what it's like to sit down to a decent meal with somebody who has recently become a vegetarian. Lawyers who have recently converted to mediating are no better. And the enthusiasm with which they pick up their newfound enthusiasm and hope to live down years of guilt can be quite nauseating. And those of us who mediate because we're ashamed of our backgrounds are not always the best example. Converts at all stages, one needs to be aware of. I mean, even St. Paul, who's probably the best known of the lot, I think we have to draw a veil over the early professional life that he engaged in. Mediators, taking them in reverse order, we need to beware of as well, because there are too many of them, and many of them are too bad. And the blunt truth is that mediation has a bad name in many places, because there is an inexhaustible chain of bad mediators. There are more unemployable lawyers who seek employment as unemployable mediators than you can shake a stick at, and they give us a very bad name. One of the problems is that there is not enough work for lawyers to do, and a lot of them seek out mediation because they believe, God knows where the concept comes from, that it's an easy process to engage in, and one that doesn't require any kind of accreditation or recognition. And I firmly agree with Bill that that has to change. I agree with the IMI over that. It has to change, and I want to tell you about that at the end. The belief that it's an easy way, in an unstructured and amateur way, to earn a living could not be more far from the truth and is misconceived. And the failure to regulate, and the fact that there are, dare I say, a huge number of commercial concerns who make their money out of selling mediation training to people who no longer have work as lawyers so that they can become unemployable mediators, is regrettable, because those who make their money out of that kind of salesmanship and then leave the country with a new panel ever increasing of accredited mediators do not have to live with the consequences. And finally, on my three bears, my three bewares, beware the lawyers. I just say this, I'll say a word about lawyers in a moment, because I'm not here on a lawyer knocking exercise. I've been one for many years myself. But beware the lawyer who tells you that mediation is a waste of time, because it usually means that he is afraid that it will not be. The lawyer who tells you that the case will not settle by mediation and it's a waste of time is usually afraid of the consequences. It's fashionable for mediators, and indeed some arbitrators, to knock lawyers as if they were some evil concept, or lawyers are not hugely popular. We all know that. It's quite important to remember, before praising mediators and arbitrators too highly, that lawyers sometimes only become popular when the need for them really emerges in a breaking down society. Lawyers have a hugely important role to play in maintaining and, in some cases, re-establishing the rule of law when it ceases to exist and when it breaks down. I have worked with some inspirationally courageous lawyers in many places in the world, some of whom have even given their lives in the course of cases which others would not have wished to take on. The idea that we knock them because they make money out of other people's discomfiture is only one side of the coin. They have a hugely important role, and yes, of course it is right that there are some cases, and I'm not just talking about what are now called fashionably human rights cases, there are commercial cases that are not suited to mediation, there are commercial cases where there are issues of principle that are difficult to resolve and probably impossible to resolve by mediation. But beware, as lawyers, the client who talks about principle. Over the years when I had what I called a practice, I often used to have clients telling me that it was a matter of principle, and on the whole, when people told me that it was a matter of principle, I'm afraid I was reminded of the misplaced quotation, because it wasn't in fact Hermann Göring, was it? It was the play. But the remark that every time I hear the word culture, I reach for my revolver. Every time I heard the word principle, I used to tell clients, I'm sorry, principles are not something lawyers deal with. We win cases and we get you money, but if you want principles, please go somewhere else. But of course, facetiousness aside, there are issues of principle which are difficult to resolve by any kind of mediation. But the belief that mediation is some kind of an amateur process that is only suitable to domestic disputes equally could not be more wrong in the other direction. Lawyers don't always make good mediators. I admired hugely, and I can say agreed, I wasn't surprised with every single word that Bill said. The only one word that I would add is this: some of the best mediators that I have worked with have not been lawyers, and I think that as a body we would do well to welcome into the broad church those who have other skills. And I want to say a word about that, if I may, at the end, talking about the way in which we've developed our panel, particularly in Singapore, and the way we would like to share it with you here. I mean it when I say it's pretty humbling for someone like me, because yes, I was a lawyer, but not of the kind of lawyer like Bill or of the distinguished lawyers that you've got present here. Somebody trying to be kind about Clement Attlee once said to Winston Churchill, well, Mr. Churchill, at least Mr. Attlee is a humble man. And Churchill, with characteristic kindness, replied, yes, Mr. Attlee has a lot to be humble about. And I'm afraid the same applies to me. I have a lot to be humble about. I'm not like these polished international lawyers. I left school when I was 15. I started work as an office boy outside in a lawyer's office. Even at that age, as a child, I was troubled that the interests of the client did not always seem to be at the forefront of people who were old enough to be my grandparents and who appeared to me as a child to be making a huge amount of money doing comparatively ordinary work, and for the most part doing it in rather a casual and amateur way. I ran away from home, and later as a teenager I became a policeman, a different kind of lawyer, but still a lawyer. I've actually been in the law now for, I think, well, over half a century. I've given up counting. As a young policeman, still starting as a teenager, I was seriously worried about some of the behavior that I saw and some of the behavior that society regarded as acceptable in the relationship between the representatives of the state and private individuals. I gave that up, did a degree, and became a legal academic. That stage, I didn't last very long because I wasn't clever enough, but even the time when I was lecturing in law at a university, I was troubled about really whether or not law is a proper academic subject and whether or not the people that we were producing at the end of the day were best fitted to go out in society and represent people. I got into a certain amount of trouble. I remember at the end of the first session, when the young lawyers who had just graduated, partly as a result or perhaps despite my attentions, left to become trainee solicitors and barristers, and as part of the sort of nunc dimittis, I told them that they were rather like human sperm in that they stood a 1 in 3 million chance of developing into human beings. It did not go down very well with the university authorities, but I think they understood the point that I meant. And throughout what I've called my legal career, I think I have become increasingly concerned. I hope that I played a part in doing some cases and doing some important work, and I'm proud of some of that. But for the most part, practicing in commercial law, as I have done for just over 45 years, you do become worried about the way it is going and the extent to which the interests of the clients are put second and sometimes third. I confess for my own part, the last major piece of international litigation in which I was engaged, we attempted to mediate the problem at a very early stage. The other side declined. There was nothing that I could do about it because in the divided profession that I have, my job was to work in court as an advocate, as a Queen's Counsel, and not to advise at the ordinary level, so I withdrew my advice and quietly got on with preparing the case. 3 years later, the case settled before we got to court, so I never ever got to my feet. By that stage, the fees of the two law firms engaged almost precisely equaled $300 million. That was almost exactly 300 times the sum that was at stake. I do not think that I could have had a clearer example of the regret that some of us felt that the efforts to mediate it before the proceedings were served had fallen on such deaf ears. And of course it is right that those passionate like myself about mediation now, those ex-lawyers, and again I repeat, I'm not knocking them in any sense at all, the utterly charismatic and amazing Michael Leith, who I am hugely proud to count as a friend and who did so much for us when we were setting up the International Mediation Center. I can be rude about him now because I've got the microphone and he hasn't. And if it weren't for him, I wouldn't be here. He's to blame. But it's fair to say that in the days when we first knew Michael, when he was the in-house counsel to one of the most aggressive corporations in the world, it was widely said of Michael that he would sue anything that moved, and if it didn't move, he would kick it until it did move and then sue it. And now, as I say, he is the inspirational godfather, in the at least English sense of that word, of international mediation, and a man hugely admired by all of us. Alex Oddie, who will be talking to you on the panel later on, is again an amazing example of an international law firm, probably one of the best international law firms in the world, in Herbert Smith Freehills, who actually encourage mediation and put the interests of their clients first. And they have a whole department that does nothing else. And some of his partners indeed are distinguished mediators in their own right. And then of course you have right down at the forefront of it, Mike McIlrath, who is so passionate and so enthusiastic about mediation that when I had the choice, when we opened the Singapore International Mediation Center, of choosing any person in the world to speak on our behalf at our opening, I chose him, and he made an inspirational and hugely valuable welcoming address for us, even though with conspiracy of the two Michaels, he's now getting his own back on it today. It's somewhat odd, isn't it, that I, as a foreigner, should be speaking about Singapore, and some of you are wondering what on earth I'm doing there. The true answer is one that I'm not particularly proud of. It is just that the journeys that I travel tend to get longer as I search for jurisdictions to which my reputation has not yet spread, but working in Singapore has been something of an inspiration. As a foreigner and as an outsider in Singapore, I can say one or two things to its credit before I say what I hope that we can do in cooperation with the typically generous Americans to help the new chamber here. Singapore, I believe, has rightly for many years, it has its failings and it has its faults and it has its critics, but it has a judiciary which is internationally renowned for competence and for integrity. There is, almost without question, no judicial corruption there at all. It has probably the best arbitration center, certainly in Asia and arguably in the world. The Singapore International Arbitration Center is absolutely magnificent and an example to many. And it had an embryonic but enthusiastic young mediation center, the Singapore Mediation Center, which set up to handle court-based mediation and domestic mediation, was doing a better job than I have seen in many of the jurisdictions in which I have worked. So what went wrong? The clients began to complain. Michael and I were present at an international arbitration forum in 2012 when two of the most litigious and most powerful reinsurance companies in the world delivered a stinging public attack on dispute resolution in Singapore. In a nutshell, they complained that despite its qualities, paying tribute to the judiciary and to the arbitration center and to the mediation center, the end result was too expensive, it was too costly, it was too slow, and in the case of mediation, it simply didn't deliver the results that they were interested in. Because they do things in Singapore and they make sure that the trains run on time, they immediately set to acknowledge the criticism and to attempt to address it. And they set up an international panel, which I was very privileged to chair. I really still to this day, I don't know why, but there was no one else around. I did it and I leant heavily on Michael Leith while I was doing it. We inquired into what we thought was going wrong and we conducted openly a major online email survey of all potential users of all dispute resolution services in Singapore to see what the problems were. And as a result of that, we came out within 6 months, we delivered a report. Being Singapore, it passed into legislation within 3 months of the delivery of our report. It's incredible, isn't it? That's the way they do things there. But I think that the four things that I wanted to share with you, and I hope share with the Florence International Mediation Chamber, were really the three C's that we have established in Singapore. They are competence, clarity, comfort, and conclusion. The panel that we set up, I think, is now internationally recognized as probably the most impressive international panel anywhere in the world. It is genuinely expert. It consists of representatives from 12 different jurisdictions speaking 12 languages, supported by an independent panel of experts. One of the problems with international mediation centers is that they tend to recruit people with names, some of whom are not even accredited or qualified at all, but look very impressive, who most litigants would be utterly mad to allow them to arbitrate or mediate across the road, let alone mediate a piece of international. We have addressed that problem, and we have set it up with that panel, every member of which is extraordinarily impressive. And incidentally, as a board of directors, we have refused to be on that panel ourselves because I think in too many cases these panels are set up to provide jobs for the boys, and there is a rightful suspicion that the administration and the panel that is set up is in fact simply creating work for themselves and handing it round to a small and incestuous circle. We also recognize that there was a need, and I think that probably with the help of IMI we were the first body to recognize this, there was a need for a clear and transparent distinction between the providers of mediation and the regulators. Again, echoing what Bill said so much more clearly and authoritatively than I could, the need for some kind of transparent and clear accreditation that is, and indeed, dare I say, regulatory in the proper sense, like any other profession, with disciplinary powers and rights of parties to object and complain. And so it was that, quite independently of the Singapore International Mediation Center, we asked the government, and they did, the Ministry of Law, to set up the Singapore International Mediation Institute with exclusive control over recommendations of those to whom we might appoint to our panel and of the regulation and the accreditation of what they did, so that the public, both in Asia and worldwide, could see that the panel was truly independent of those who were regulating it and authorizing and accrediting those to set it up. Thirdly, only because it was a C, I talked about comfort, we established dedicated facilities. Again, I agree with what has been done here. It is incredibly important that mediation is conducted in an environment that is suitable, and you need different types of room depending on the type of dispute and the type of client that you've got. You will use wholly different facilities with different decoration and furniture if you are mediating a dispute between Chinese international constructors and international financiers than you would if you were dealing with a domestic dispute between two local companies. You think about that, but the important thing is the facilities need to be appropriate to the case that you're working in. I think that mediators are not always aware, and in my experience, lawyers are not always aware of the suspicion that there is when you go for the cheap alternative. And you toss a coin and you say, we'll conduct the mediation in the claimant's or the plaintiff's solicitor's office, without any thought to how badly that may go down with the clients on the other side. I don't single them out, but in Asia particularly, where face is incredibly important, and that's not just a one-sided thing, loss of face is important for the other side as well as for yourself. It's not just a selfish interest in your own arrogance. Respect for the face of your opponent is equally important to any genuine subscriber to Confucian philosophy. And it's something that we've learned a lot about while mediating in Asia. You need a neutral venue, one that is not seen by either of the parties. Never mind the lawyers. Of course they may agree that they will share and take turns in sharing the facilities and paying for the coffee and the lunch. That is not what satisfies. The client wants to know, why am I being taken by apparently an independent mediator to work in the lawyers who act for and are paid by my opponent? Equally, an extremely difficult mediation that I recently conducted about a considerable sum of money, 40 billion rand, between Asian construction infrastructure contractors and the South African government. Most unwisely, I found that we were sitting in hotel rooms where there were not proper facilities. There wasn't even sufficient acoustic division and distinction between the rooms. The amount of distrust that caused one party to walk out on the second, either the second or the third night. We ran for 5 days and five nights before we cracked it. But again, the need for the mediation chamber to provide those facilities that are appropriate and independent is hugely important. And finally, the conclusion, the result. In my experience, which is of many hundreds of mediations now, in the international mediation particularly, the client wants a conclusion that he can take away with and enforce. Mediators frequently tell their clients, don't worry about it, we will come to a settlement, we will draw up the settlement, and you will go home with a contract that you can take to your local court in Beijing and enforce. And the client will say, yes, I had one of those contracts, that's why we're here. I don't want another of those. I want something that I can go and register in my court. And only just now recently recognized, even by Ancestral, the need for New York Convention compliant registerable results of mediation is almost the Holy Grail. Until mediation can produce results when required in the form of an enforceable award or judgment, mediation will not satisfy the interests, particularly of the Asian community. And I don't want to be racist about it, because the same applies, believe it or not, to quite a number of European domestic countries that are not multinational. They want an award, they want a settlement that they can enforce. And that is what we do take some pride for inventing, because there's been a lot of talk about ARB-MED, there's been a lot of talk about MED-ARB, but no one else has produced, other than Singapore, the ARB-MED-ARB clause, which we want to share, particularly with this body and with anybody else who is patient enough to listen. Very simply, and I have little time, so I'll reduce it literally to a few minutes, what we're trying to do is, instead of knocking arbitration, to recognize that mediation can only work in an international commercial community if it works hand in hand with both arbitration and, where appropriate, with the court services. There is nothing wrong with referring the dispute to arbitration on a full, acknowledged, and registered basis. And once the dispute is registered for arbitration, all that a single arbitrator does, may I just describe to you the way it works in Singapore. So an arbitrator in Singapore, appointed by SIAC, will simply give the minimum of directions, literally just to say, this is the bundle of documents, must be limited in size, the pleadings must be limited to no more than so many pages, and the position papers should be exchanged within a certain time. That sets up a perfectly genuine arbitration. He then refers the arbitration to the Singapore International Mediation Centre, which shares offices, and indeed it shares a chief executive, in that the chief executive is the incomparable Siew Khee Lim, who runs both institutions. And the mediator then takes over and attempts to mediate the dispute. Being Singapore, of course, every single mediation that we attempt, we succeed in. But it is possible that there may be mediators in the room who failed to succeed in mediations. I can't think that they would have been invited to attend, but it is conceivable that 1% of cases fail. If the mediation fails, nothing is lost, and I really mean nothing, because the work that has been done is not wasted. It is concentrated effort. It will have simplified the discovery process, it will have simplified the pleadings, and it will have concentrated minds on the real issue. And nothing is lost by, other than perhaps a week or two of time, than the issue being referred back to the arbitrator. The arbitrator then invites the parties to appoint the two nominated parties from either side, and the arbitration sails on, no more expensively, with no further time, other than perhaps the 2 weeks that were taken to look at the mediation. Nothing is lost. And if the mediation succeeds, the mediator draws up the mediated settlement in exactly the same way as we've always done, but she or he passes it to the arbitrator, who then perfectly properly registers it as an award. It is not a sham in the way in which ARBMED is a sham, because of course if you make an arbitration award at a time when there never has been a dispute, it will not comply with the New York Convention because it will be a sham. But our award is not a sham because there was, I remind you, at the time when the arbitration was registered, a perfectly proper and lawfully constituted arbitration which complied with the New York Convention. And when the parties, through mediation or through handshake or for any other reason, settle, the fact that they arrived at a conclusion that is then capable of being registered in an award does not in any way prevent it from being New York compliant. And that is what we have created and what we would share with anybody who is prepared to listen and to work with us. It is with huge pride, with very, very real pleasure, that we will be working on devices such as that to make a contribution, because equally, we believe that mediation centres should not simply sit in their own palaces and invite everybody to come to them, because, as James said this morning, one of the important points that CEDA has learned is, why on earth should we as mediators sit in our chambers in London and wait until it is convenient for somebody to fly in from Texas and Auckland at our convenience? If the mediation that you are dealing with happens to be in Naples, presumably you would be prepared to go there. And I simply don't understand why mediators are at the moment reluctant to go to the client rather than the other way around. And that is why certainly we in Singapore will be enthusiastic and willing to come here to share mediations, to share our experience and to share the work. And it will be as much of an honor and a pleasure as it has been for me to address you and to thank you for the patience with which you've kindly listened to me, despite the fact that I was not the person you thought I was going to be. But thank you for your patience.
Thanks to Mr. Glasgow. Now we go on with the second panel discussion. So the issue is the mediation process, techniques for getting a good result anywhere in the world. Mediator techniques for promoting settlement, mediation advocacy, party techniques and strategies to negotiate for advantage. Mediation arbitration, does it work? We are going to have the examples of the Singapore International Mediation Centers and the Singapore International Arbitration Center. So I invite all the speakers to come to the table. We will have Mr. Michael McLeodroth to be the moderator. I remember you, this is the Global Chief Litigation Counsel of General Electric Oil and Gas. Then we will have Spela Kozak, am I right? She's the manager of the International Center for ADR of the International Chamber of Commerce in Paris. Then we have Mr. Harold Coleman Jr. He's Senior Vice President of the American Arbitration Association and the International Center for Dispute Resolution based in New York. We have also Alexander Oddi, who is partner, mediation advocate, and head of ADR at Herbert Smith Freehills, based in London. And Michael Leeds, executive director of IMI, and Singapore International Mediation Institute deputy chairman from UK. I only need to ask you kindly to talk close to the microphone, because the hall is quite inspiring, but the acoustic is not at the best unless you talk to the technical things.
Thank you. My name is Mike McElrath, and I'm going to start by, because the acoustics here are difficult, and we're going to have some fun, and we want to be interactive, I'm going to ask people to move up. Come on. Everybody who came to get the crediti forensi came, signed, and left this morning. So now the people here are ones who actually are interested. So move forward. Or let me put it this way. If you believe that lawyers should waste the money of their clients, stay in the last five rows. If you believe that lawyers should help clients find business solutions, sit in the first group up in front. All right, just to be clear, say, credete che gli avvocati dovrebbero sprecare i soldi dei clienti? I posti sono riservati, sono le ultime cinque file. Rimanete lì, facciamo la foto dopo, ok? Let's make sure we capture those who insist on remaining. As I work in this town, and I want to see them, get some names of those people. And now, this panel, and I'm going to invite people just to because the acoustics are terrible. Just if you have something to say, hold your hand up, and we'll try to include it. The format is a quiz format, based on a program you can hear on the internet called Wait, Wait, Don't Tell Me, which is, it's a quiz, and you have multiple choice questions and answers. They don't know the answers that they're going to be given. They're going to have to answer accurately or defend the answers, and we're going to mostly speak today about techniques, negotiation and mediation techniques that can help parties get good results in a mediation. But actually, I'm going to start with a question that has a little bit out here. We have Shpela Kosak here, who heads the ADR mediation practice for the International Chamber of Commerce in Paris. And you're from Slovenia, yes? Yes.
That's absolutely correct.
You're from Slovenia, yes. And when we knew that Spela would be on the panel, we called the former Minister of Justice of Slovenia, Aleš Zalar, who's a big supporter of mediation. And we said, Aleš, we're going to have one of your fellow Slovenians on the panel. What should we say to her? And I'm going to read three sentences, and Spela has to guess what is it that the Minister of Justice, actually he's the Minister of Justice and also the Minister, I think, of the Homeland and Security. Did he say, Spela, come back to Slovenia. It is more beautiful than Paris, and the people are much nicer. Did he say, Spela, can you explain why mediation clauses in contracts are still not used by Slovenian lawyers and companies, despite widely practiced mediation and court-annexed mediation schemes in Slovenia? Or did he say, Spela, I hope you understand your job at the ICC is to promote Ljubljana as the preferred place of mediation in Europe?
Well, I have to say that's a tricky one, you know? Because if I would not know what's the purpose of this panel here, I would say A. And everybody
who has been in Slovenia
and in Paris would agree with me, you know? Yeah. It's definitely A. But, you know, knowing
well, that assumes he wants you back in Slovenia.
Yeah, definitely, for sure. Because Slovenia is much more beautiful than Paris. but I would have to go for a B, I'm afraid. And I guess Slovenia faces the same problem as any other countries, that there is still not enough of knowledge about the mediation, there is still mistrust about the mediation, and I think events like this, and IMI, and everybody passionate about mediation here, we are here to change that.
Okay, great. Actually, you got it right. He did say B. All right, one point for Spela. Yeah. All right, 1 point, yay, yay. Alex, would you care to comment on the criticism? Now, it's interesting that this criticism comes from Aleš Zalar, from the former Minister of Justice of the country, because he's one of the greatest supporters of mediation. In fact, he's on the advisory council of the International Mediation Institute. You come from Herbert Smith Freehills, which is an international law firm, which, if you don't mind my saying, has a reputation for being sort of the red-blooded, red meat litigation lawyers. And yet you are sponsors of the Global Pound Conference, which we hope, it would be great to have it now with the FIMC, that Florence would be one of the cities among at least probably 30 or more cities around the world in 2016, we'll be discussing the future of dispute resolution. All right, let me ask you, why do you think that companies are not using mediation more in their contracts?
In part it's understanding, for sure. But some organizations nevertheless choose not to. And smart organizations sometimes choose not to because they don't feel that a mediation clause that is mandatory and requires them to go through the process is essential for every dispute that arises. And that's fine. Different companies take different views, but what it does require is in-house counsel who have an understanding of when to make good choices, and it requires those organizations to work with external counsel, with law firms that understand when to make good choices, whether there's a contract clause there or not. So it's great when an organization chooses that that's effective, but the process can still be used and should still be used a lot, even when there aren't those clauses in place.
Great. Any other comments?
Mike, let me say that I heard a very interesting comment from a top-notch lawyer from a top-flight firm who's offered a different view. He says, you know, I don't want to be bound to a mediation provision in my dispute resolution contracts. He says, if the other side is represented by competent counsel, counsel have a way of knowing when the case is right for mediation. We don't want to have a clause or a provision that has compulsory effect to force us to mediate before we're truly ready. And I thought it was really interesting observation, so I played a little mediator thing. Tell me more about that and what was driving it. And he felt that when there is a mediation clause, it gets parties there earlier than they otherwise might be ready. Now, I happen to believe that is a good thing to have that kind of provision, and the parties can always determine for themselves when the appropriate time is, and in many cases when you have litigated cases before a court will give them enough breathing room in terms of an amount of time to mediate. So I don't think that's justification not to have a mediation provision. But it was just interesting, his observation that I don't want to be told to mediate in a contract clause. I had never heard that before in 25 years.
Interesting. Now, we include a mediation. Actually, I have to be careful because I actually have mediations now pending with Stella's organization. But the reason they're pending is because there's a step clause in our contract, actually. We have arbitration, we have a mediation requirement. And that's, we find sometimes that's the only way we get there. But Alex, let me get to you now. Next question. This is, now we're going to move into the mediation, and we're going to talk about effective negotiation techniques. I'm going to give you three negotiation strategies and ask you to choose which one most mediators would say is the most effective way. Okay. Option A, hardball tactics, such as saying take it or leave it, or threatening to leave the mediation. B, making an effective, well-timed first offer to settle. Or C, using the plenary session to convince the mediator they have a strong case. Let me repeat. So first one is hardball tactics, take it or leave it, or I'm going to leave, making an effective first offer, or using the plenary session to convince the mediator you have a strong case.
Well, you oftentimes will see strategy A deployed, and it can be deployed effectively, but I think the answer that you might be looking for is B, making a well-timed offer. I can certainly say that C, trying to persuade the mediator, means that the party involved has misunderstood what the mediator is there to do, because the mediator doesn't need to be persuaded. The person that needs to be persuaded is across the other side of the table. That's the decision maker who matters. And so I think, as a mediation advocate, my focus would be on helping them understand the way to see the problem from a different angle, and then timing an appropriate offer on a reasoned basis with explanations of why I'm making that offer at the earliest point I felt they were ready to receive that in the mediation process.
Any other views, A, B, or C? Hardball tactics, first offers, or convincing the mediator?
Or D, that red meat approach you spoke of earlier.
Well,
right?
Your options, these are my questions. Your options are A, B, or C here. Which one would you say, most mediators would say, this one of these is the most effective way to get a good result for the party?
It has to be B.
You all say B. Audience, any views? You all think that making a good first offer is a good way? In fact, the answer is B. Yes, the judges say B. You got that one right. One point for Alex. So Alex, let's go back to you now. Next question, again on negotiation technique, representing parties in a mediation. I'm going to ask you something about what I do. You're going to have to guess. I'm the judge here. So I teach negotiation classes at GE at Nuova Opinione. And in my classes, I tell students that there is, to our project managers, our business people, that there are three things that they should bring to every mediation. In fact, I won't go with them unless they bring these three things with them to the mediation. What are these three things? Option A, lunch, money for dinner, and the name of the other side. B, their goal, their bottom line, and the amount of their first offer or the counter offer they intend to make. Or C, three good books to read because the mediation could take a very long time.
The correct answer, Mike, is actually all of the above. because you certainly need to bring some lunch money because you can never be sure the other side will produce enough good sandwiches or serve you a decent cup of coffee, so you need to make preparations. You certainly need to bring some books to read or some other work to do because you need to keep a negotiating team engaged through a long day, and they will get worn out and tired and stressed if you keep them going too long. But the most important answer is B, because you need people to be focused on their strategy and to have thought about it beforehand, and so their goal, their bottom line, and critically their first offer or counter offer is definitely the most important thing. So answer B for me.
Any comments from the...
I object.
Yes?
I object to a B only insofar as this bottom line thinking can really be a negative influence at mediation. A far more strategic way of determining what a party's response ought to be to perhaps even that last proposal on the table is a very detailed evaluation of alternatives as opposed to bottom line. Let me just give a real brief illustration. I want you to assume you have a case where 100,000 euro is what's being demanded. And a party determines prior to mediation that their walk point is 75,000. If they don't get at least 75,000, that's their bottom line. They're walking, they're not going to engage the process. There's nothing else to talk about. When in fact, what if maybe the final and best offer that is placed on the table by the other party is 60,000 euro. If we use bottom line thinking, that party who said, if I don't get 75,000, I'm walking, they could really do themselves a disservice. Why? Because if you go through a detailed evaluation of alternatives and include in that the risk, the probabilities of success, et cetera, they may come to learn that 60,000 euros is not so bad. One thing I've always felt as a mediator is that the present value of a guaranteed sum, something they can get today, is oftentimes worth far more than the speculative value of a future sum when you consider the risk and the cost to get it. So I am fundamentally opposed to bottom line thinking prior to mediation. Now I know parties say that, and when I hear it as a mediator, I say, yeah, I let it roll right off my back because I know what's true at 10 a.m. may not be true at 4 p.m. So far better than bottom line, what my bottom line is, what is a detailed evaluation of my alternatives when I consider the cost and the risk? And I'm going to be open-minded about every proposal that's put forward and not blow any off or walk too quickly because of some mechanical, perhaps even arbitrary, assessment of the value of my case.
Michael, any?
I would just add the importance of the lunch bit. Okay, well, you're dealing with human beings. And if you can break bread together, not necessarily over lunch, often over dinner the night before a mediation, the psychological effect of sharing something, however off-center from the subject of dispute, can produce the most dramatic possible effects the following day. It's not lunch, it's dinner. I've seen it work remarkably indeed. The very first time I experienced a mediation, it was in the United States. The mediator actually insisted that the parties joined him for dinner the night before and specifically insisted that the subject of the dispute was not discussed over dinner. And you know what? We settled the case over dinner.
What if they can't agree on the menu?
One guy's
got a food allergy.
Isn't that a great thing to be able to to negotiate?
By the way, I intended the correct answer to be either all of the above or B, so we give Alex full credit.
Yeah,
so
I would give Alex
bing,
the points.
But let me
with
say,
modification.
But by the way, for point B being important, Professor Hal Abramson wrote a book called Mediation Representation, and he actually recommends in that book that counsel, when they bring their parties to mediation, make sure that with their client, and I think he would agree with you, Harold, you have to avoid the bottom line thinking, but he does say that they should bring their key financial parameters with them to every mediation that they attend. And I can tell you from being a party, and the reason that I tell people to do this is I find so many instances people have heard, to be a good negotiator, you have to be a good listener. You know, I have to go and I have to listen. And in doing that, my experience has been people forget that they also need to have an objective, a goal that they hope to obtain, and people find that they get their bottom line shifted because they don't have a goal. They go to the mediation, they let the other side anchor the negotiation by being the first ones to put an offer on the table, and it shifts their perspective, and we find that we can actually get a better result if we actually think in advance of what do we really expect to get out of this. By the way, I'm going to comment on your comment, which is another point about food being important. In his book Thinking Fast and Slow, which is about the neurology of decision making, Daniel Kahneman, the Nobel Prize, I think he won the Nobel Prize for some of the work that he's done, an incredible, incredible book, Thinking Fast and Slow, talks about the impact of glucose levels of food on your decision making process, and he cites a study done with Israeli criminal court judges who were asked to all of them had at least 12 years of experience, and the study they performed was of the decisions of whether or not to grant probation to prisoners, and what they found was if the request or the decision was in the mornings, shortly after breakfast, that there was something like a 60% or higher tendency to grant the request. As you got on in the morning, as you got around this time, getting close to lunch, the willingness to grant parole dropped to close to zero. And the theory is the brain is a hungry organism. and it becomes depleted. It's very energy consuming, and if it becomes depleted of energy, it won't work hard. So it does the easy thing. It won't do the hard work. So I tell people, if you're going to a difficult negotiation, to a difficult mediation, you know, make sure that you're not going to be making decisions on an empty stomach. Mm-hmm.
I think psychology and human nature tend not to be thought about as much as they should in any negotiation process, whether it's assisted by a mediator or not. And we should all know about these things and react to them.
Well, Michael, now we'll turn to you. So as you've heard virtually everybody say so far here, basically we're all your children here in international media, which I have to warn you, as you know, being a parent, does not mean that we're going to act very well necessarily.
No, no,
you can expect your children, you know, are not necessarily going to engage in good behavior. In fact, let me ask you, you're now a mediator, you're acting as a mediator in a hotly contested dispute, and you just delivered the opening offer. You communicated to the claimant the opening offer of the respondent. The claimant is very upset and says angrily that that number is outrageously high or low, depending on where we are. As a good mediator, you would likely A, respectfully suggest the claimant make a counteroffer that you will convey to the respondent. B, go tell the respondent to apologize for their outrageously high offer and to make a new one that the claimant will like more. Or C, end the mediation. It is obvious the parties are too far apart to settle. A is suggest a counteroffer. B, tell the respondent to apologize and come back with a better offer. Or C, end the mediation. This is futile.
I don't know, actually. I would consider all three and probably other potential options. I would obviously think that we're being positional. It would go through my mind how to get both parties away from their positions. It's not just about offers and counteroffers. It's about what's behind them. It's about leverage and each side's leverage. I would need to know more to decide whether this is deadlock that cannot be overcome. Probably, almost certainly not. Certainly at an early stage. Therefore, my instinct would be, just gotta be A, but not necessarily come up with a counteroffer. Let's talk about it. Let's chat it through, either together or separately. But I would start with open questions. I would start wanting to know more. I think the parties need to share discussion in order to find a pathway through it.
Harold?
So that would be my answer.
Harold, what do you think?
I substantially agree with Michael. I would say this, though. My answer would be D. It depends. I was always one of those kinds in law school who wanted to fight the hypothetical. So that's what I'm doing here. No, you know what it depends on for me? Here's the necessary predicate. When you're in a purely positional framework and exchanging numbers, it's what I call objective basis. What I really encourage parties to do is to really help me to understand through some measure of objectivity the basis to that offer, even if it's going to be met with unpopularity by the other party. That's okay if there's an objective basis. If it is designed to insult, to inflame, to send a negative message, I resist communicating that offer. Now, they can do it, but I try not to get involved with exchanging offers that really don't have a probability of causing another party to seriously consider it and help us to move the ball forward. So if they're on an objective basis, and that claimant let me know that, and I could then explain that to the other party, I would be apt to communicate it, but in a way that would encourage the other party to continue to engage this process, and let's figure out our next move.
You know what I would do, Hal? What I would do is consider asking each side to present the other side's case in the first person singular.
Yep.
Okay? I would turn them upside down.
Yes.
I would award an Oscar to the best acting performance. I would prohibit an expression like "they say." I would ask them to break. I would ask them to come back in 20 minutes. I would ask them to go through that performance, and then we'll talk. Because putting yourself in the other person's shoes is fundamentally what parties do not do.
Well, I had planned for the correct answer to be A, tell them to make a counteroffer, but I'm going to put it to the audience. Do we give him full credit for the answer? Who says he should get, if you applaud if you think he gets full credit? Okay. Okay. Now clap if you think we should give him zero. I'll give you full credit. All right? You
get, whoa, yeah. Wow.
Audience gives you credit for that. Harold, let's turn to you now. I'm going to ask you a question about arbitration, which is something that your organization knows something about, the American Arbitration Association and the International Center for Dispute Resolution. But I'm not going to ask you about the American Arbitration Association rules. I'm going to ask you about the ICC rules of Spella, who's sitting next to you, and ask Spella to comment afterwards. Now, the ICC issued new arbitration rules in 2012. These rules have guidelines for arbitrators on how to conduct proceedings. And there's an appendix, actually, on effective case management. It's an appendix to the arbitration rules. What do they say about mediation? Do they say, move that document away from him, please. Do they say, A, arbitrators should not suggest the parties consider mediation because this could create grounds later to challenge the arbitration award on due process grounds. B, if the arbitrators can convince the parties to settle, they will earn both the arbitrator and the mediator fees, and they will not need to do the extra work of drafting the arbitration award. Or do they say, C, the arbitrators should encourage the parties to consider using the ICC's ADR services at a suitable time in the proceeding?
This is one I can't dodge or change the hypo. You nailed me on this one, Michael. Well, you got to throw out B. That's nonsensical. I mean, it's double dipping into arbitration.
Just to repeat them. So A is that they should tell the parties not to consider mediation because that could be grounds for challenge the arbitration award. B, that they can get the parties to settle, they can get both mediation and arbitration fees, or C, encourage at an appropriate time.
And the correct answer is, can I get a drum roll, audience? All right, correct answer is C, Charlie. And in particular, it's Appendix 4, Subsection H, Settlement of Disputes, which in effect provides that the arbitration tribunal, in a permissive language, may, it's not mandatory, may, I encourage the parties to consider a settlement or such other amicable ADR mechanism that might be amenable to them under the ICC mediation rules. And then it goes on to say that when so agreed by the parties, and this is fine, and the arbitration tribunal can in fact assist the parties towards resolution, but only if it doesn't in any way affect or somehow negatively impact the integrity, the sanctity of the ultimate award. Now, this is paraphrasing, but so many words, they have to make sure that the sanctity of the award is preserved in morphing in from arbitrator into mediator and then again into an arbitrator role.
Spela, how did Harold do?
Well, Harold, I am impressed. Yeah, a round of applause for you.
You don't see the little cheat sheets going under the table over here, right?
But here's an interesting point, though. Both of you represent institutions which also offer arbitration. And, I mean, for many years, there was a concern, I would say, even paranoia in the arbitration world about arbitrators getting their hands into mediation, because that would create grounds or suspicion later that might allow a challenge. And yet you both, I mean, do it differently. You have guidelines, and I know the ICDR, basically you have the case manager, I know this, because you have the case manager send letters or call the parties and say, try our mediation services. So we're beyond the point where this is a concern anymore for the arbitration side.
I think that this is a very important role of the institution to encourage this, I would say, cross promotion, and to really make sure that the parties in the arbitration know what are the options or what are the alternatives. Now, I think ICC has made a significant effort to do that. We even have financial incentives for the parties in arbitration to try the mediation. We could, for example, appoint or propose a mediator free of charge, which, of course, at the end, this is something that parties understand when you start talking financial consequences, I would say. And we hope, the rules are fairly new, so we are still waiting to see the impact, but we hope that this is something that will encourage the parties to use mediation more. But maybe, Harold, you have what would be your view on the...
At the association and ICDR, all of our rules do provide for mediation, which can be done concurrent with arbitration. And as a matter of fact, our most recent rule amendment specifies that the mediation shall not delay the pendency or the continuity of the arbitration. So parties can proceed along parallel tracks. So we're very similar in that regard. We actively encourage our mediation. We provide panels of mediators, including what we call master mediators, to handle the largest of the large cases. And parties are free still to even mediate outside the context of the association or the International Center for Dispute Resolution if they so choose, because we really believe in this process called mediation. Where we would take perhaps a little different approach is we are not fans and advocates of what's called MEDARP, mediation and arbitration done by the same tribunal. It is just fraught with problems and disaster. And in the United States, we've had some litigated cases where, again, arbitrators have morphed into mediator, and then because the matter didn't settle, they were called upon to resume service as arbitrator with some very, very catastrophic results. So we maintain panels that are fully competent, fully able to carry out the toughest mediation, so that now the arbitrator, the arbitration tribunal, doesn't have to wear more than one hat, and they can truly be true to their calling.
And if I may just add, I completely agree with you. I think it is extremely important, because in the mediation, the arbitrator might hear information that otherwise in arbitration the parties would not be sharing with him, and that might of course influence the perception. So I think in the ICC we are on the completely same side.
Right. And then Mike, that double billing you talked about earlier.
I think that's great, but it's not great enough. The word that was expressed was may. What I thought was an even better approach, because not just because I was involved in it, but it's not my innovation, it's Edwin Glasgow's innovation, was what he explained at the end of his talk. Arb, med, arb. Starts off as an arbitration, a proper arbitration, at the point that it's the party's effective pleadings have been exchanged, it suspends itself to try mediation through a separate body. If that succeeds and a settlement is arrived at, it goes back to the arbitration body, who convert that into a consent award that is enforceable under the New York Convention. And to me, that is the perfect solution that BrainPower has yet come up with. And I would urge that this be followed.
Actually, I would say that, you know, this is a comment from living in both the arbitration and the mediation world. When you raise the notion of ARB-MED or MED-ARB, and you say, well, you can always get, people say this, you can always get a consent award, which is the equivalent of, in some countries, a consent judgment, where the judge, you know, the parties agree that the judge shall enter an order which says, not available in every country, but in many countries, and it is available in theory in arbitration. The fact is, however, it's very difficult to do in practice, because if you are mediating, and I'll pick on Spella's organization, imagine you are mediating with the ICC in an ICC proceeding, and you say, we want to now have our mediated agreement turned into an arbitration award. Well, okay, but the ICC has rules for arbitration that you have to follow. They have a court which also has to scrutinize the award, and you have to pay fees to the ICC for a lot of this, and there's no specific rule there for how the entire process should be followed. So I think it actually, interestingly enough, it was, you know, the Singapore International Mediation Center, and they could only do this because they had the support of the Singapore International Arbitration Center to have overlapping competencies where they could actually coordinate the two.
You can do that here.
But an arbitration, absent an innovation like this, an arbitration, a consent arbitration award while you're in mediation. We tried to do this one time with one of the best mediators in Europe, Bill Marsh, and he said, I can't sign this because I'm a mediator. We said, we'll appoint you. You can be our arbitrator. You sign it. He says, I can't sign it because I don't have insurance to act as an arbitrator. I have insurance as a mediator.
Right. That's right. Yeah. You've got to have separate organizations dealing with this.
I think when you want to enter this, it truly is an innovative, you know, issue that solves. I think it solves an administrative problem that lurks out there. Harold.
Oh,
time
again.
For you. All right. Again. So, mediator, you know, can give a settlement suggestion or give even a view of the strengths and weaknesses of a case. When and how should a mediator do this? A, by letter to the parties at 5 p.m. when you need to kick some juice into the mediation. B, by telling both parties in the presence of each other what you think of the case at the start of the mediation. I mean, you've read the papers. And not later than 10 a.m. Or C, only after obtaining permission from all parties and exhausting all other options.
Oh, that's an easy one. That has got to be what, folks? C, absolutely. As a matter of fact, I always like to say, and we teach our mediators this as a kind of standard technique, this business of when to and how to conduct a bit of an assessment or an evaluation at mediation. Should never be one where the mediator just injects himself or herself into the process and blurts out what they think about the positions of the parties or their possible exposure, unless there's been quite a bit of trust first, and I agree with Ben Picker earlier. Trust is so important. No manner of evaluation or assessment is going to really do that which is, should be produced to do unless the parties first trust the mediator. But in my view, a mediator gets there by one of two roads, license or permission. What does that mean? First, license. If a party asks a mediator, you know what, Mr. Picker, you've had an awful lot of experience with this. You know, one of the reasons we selected you is because of that expertise and your insights. What am I missing here? How do you see this? Ben Picker has gotten what? He's gotten license to go there. So now he can lend a perspective, an assessment. If a party has an extended license, then the way you get there is by permission. So if I'm the mediator, I'll say, you know what, Ben, I have seen a lot of these kinds of cases. You may recall that from my bio, some of the things I share with you during the opening presentation. And, you know, I have a thought here that I'd like to have you consider based on that. Would you be open to hearing that? And if he says yes, now I've got permission. If he says no, I've got a real fundamental problem, don't I? What is it? Lack of trust.
Yeah.
So again, it's a very, very important thing. It's not so much the
what. Alex, look at this. Alex, you agree with this? I mean, you're the lawyer. You've prepared the case. You've hired a mediator who's got special expertise. Don't you want to hear the mediator's view at 10 a.m. in the morning and tell the other side they're just wrong?
No. I don't really care what they think most of the time. That's not why I hired them. And so I would say of the options, C was the best, but I would say none of those because I wouldn't be interested in their views particularly. And I think there are cultural differences about how people engage in the mediation process and in terms of the way they come to evaluate their case. Anglo-Saxon people in England, the culture is not one where you like to be told what to do and to be told an answer directly. So I don't really care what the mediator wants to say to me. It's much better and more powerful if the parties find their way to the assessment of the position and find their own way to understanding their case perhaps wasn't as strong as they thought it was at the start of the day. How do you do that, or how do I try and do that as a mediation advocate? Well, what I aim to do is prepare the mediator and assist the mediator to ask questions in private sessions that allow my opposing counsel and the opposing party to reappraise their case. So it's a different way of getting to a position because I just don't much like evaluation. But I also have clients from other parts of the world who see things differently. Perhaps from the United States, where they are more comfortable with hearing an element of evaluation. Perhaps some Asian cultures expect to have some sort of opinion expressed. And so I can work with that, but it's not what I would choose with a London mindset and London perspective.
Yeah, I have to tell you, I mean, Harold, you said something as you asked people, it's obvious that the answer is C, but I have to tell you, and by the way, yes, of course you're correct, the answer is C, and in this room we would know this, but I'll tell you the reason that, one of the reasons I got involved with IMI is after having experiences with mediators who did not know that, who walked in at the beginning of the mediation and said, I've read the papers, and then this has happened to me actually multiple times where we've let the other side take the lead in choosing the mediator in order to get to mediation. And we walk in, the mediator said, well, I've read the papers. You know, I'm a professor of law here in Italy. This has happened several times here in Italy. I'm a professor of law here in Italy. I know the law. I know the facts. And yeah, you're right, you're wrong. Well, what's there to mediate? And the consequence of that has been that now the parties are so polarized, and it's actually a case where you, as a mediator, have done damage because those have, in every single case that has happened, we had a much, much more fiery, hotly contested dispute because of the damage done by what I would say was a competent arbitrator, a competent professor of law, but somebody who, you know, as a mediator, was an idiot. You know, I mean, you know. No, seriously, you could be a very good professor of law, but that doesn't mean you're good as a mediator.
Mike, if I could just say quickly, almost invariably when you see that type of dynamic where the parties have done their opening presentations and then the mediator wants to go right off and give some kind of an evaluation as to how he or she sees the case, it almost invariably is a byproduct of lack of training. They just don't have a toolbox of tools that is diverse enough and varied enough to know how to really move the process along. I would say this to Mike. I certainly agree with my good colleague Alex that we call it an evaluation, but you know, you can really do quite a bit of evaluating and assessment giving in the form of facilitative questioning. Nobody said it has to be done with declarative statements. You could actually help a party to come to their own conclusion in the spirit of an evaluation through nothing but facilitative questioning. So I agree with you. And that might be a need for a party, and a good astute mediator will be able to read where the parties are and really what they need for the good of the process.
Yeah, that's absolutely correct.
That's a good point.
Say it nice and loud, Mike. Michael, what was it?
I said that's absolutely correct.
All right.
You know, I've seen mediators who evaluate just by the way they look at you.
Yes.
After you've made a statement. You can tell when somebody thinks you're a complete jerk from what you've just said. And they also, you can get no signal at all from them. And how the mediator controls herself or himself in an interactive dialogue with the parties or individual parties is a massive skill, human skill of a mediator, requiring immense amount of not only training, but practice.
Yes.
Spella. We've got, you've got 1 point. Two of your colleagues here have two. Let's see if you can catch them. The claimant in a mediation conducted by the ADR group of the ICC, which you are the head of, calls the ICC and calls the case manager to complain about the performance of the mediator. She says, the mediator forced us to settle. They want their money back. What do you do? A, laugh. B, tell them that you will give them the money back, but only if they spend it on psychological counseling. Or C, diplomatically explain the purpose of mediation and how it was to reach a settlement, which they seem to have gotten as a result of their experience. So A, laugh, which you already are. B, offer the refund, but only for psychological counseling. Or C, do some work explaining the mediation process.
Well, I guess as everybody who works with people, we are sometimes tempted to say A or B. but of course, we know better, and we would, of course, try to explain.
Now, do parties make this complaint? And the reason I put this question down is I had a conversation a few years ago with Jay Welsh, who's the general counsel of JAMS, and a competitor of your two organizations here in the U.S., also a member of IMI. And he said that the single biggest complaint that he hears about mediators is that they forced the parties to settle. And he basically said, I don't know what to say to an answer like that. I mean, you know, they're complaining that we gave them the product that they came to us for. Is that a complaint that you guys hear?
I have not heard this one yet. we do not get, I would say, much complaints about the mediators, but of course not all of the cases settle successfully. I mean, that is the fact. But I would say that the important role of the institution behind it, it's also to help the parties to make informed decisions. So this is specifically if one of the parties would like to try the mediation and they do not have a previous agreement, for example, in the contract, sometimes it helps to have a neutral institution behind who conveys the message and can explain the parties what's the mediation, what is good out of it, how can they profit out of the process. And obviously, one of the first things we say, you know, mediation, it's much faster and much cheaper than arbitration or litigation. And even if it fails, the max you lose, it's a little proportion of the money. Yeah. And very little time in the life of dispute, so you should definitely try it. So, of course, there are also other things that institution can bring, such as dealing, you know, with financial matters. I guess this relieves mediators and the parties from directly negotiating about the money, which it's always, I guess, a bit sensitive topic if you want to be, you know, friends with the mediator.
Harold's just dying to get in here. So, Harold,
I'm dying on each one of them.
Do people come? You hear this complaint?
Yeah, not from about our panelists. I honestly say that our panelists are held to
because you're better than
yes. Well, you know, we're held to the model standards of conduct for mediators, which were promulgated by the American Bar Association, American Arbitration Association, and the Association for Conflict Resolution, and which in the United States have had the force and effect of law by many court systems that have adopted them. The point I'd like to make is this. Standard one of the model standards is party self-determination. The parties have the right to self-determine both as to process and outcome. If we were to investigate a complaint of one of our panelists engaging in coercive conduct that is antithetical to standard one, that panelist would be removed from our panel. This process is the byproduct of party self-determination.
But assuming they didn't infringe that, I'd probably ask for a success fee.
There you go. Michael, everybody else has 2 points. You're at one.
Oh, right.
This is your chance to bring up a tie. In his book, which we've mentioned, multiple people have mentioned today, Getting to Yes, co-author William Ury suggests that parties in a difficult negotiation can sometimes handle the situation best if they go to the balcony. By this, by go to the balcony, does he mean A, take a break to get some fresh air, B, abstract themselves from the emotions of the negotiation and focus on their interests, or C, have a realistic plan of escape in things in case things get dangerous? So A, take a break, get some fresh air. B, remove yourself from the emotions and focus on the issues and your interests. Or C, escape plan.
Instinct tells me it's a combination of A and B. Go to the balcony actually was not in Getting to Yes, it was in Getting Past No.
Oh, you're right, you're Getting Past No. That's right, yes.
And what William Ury meant by it was avoid confrontation where confrontation is avoidable and take time out. Mm-hmm. And the good trainers and you folks that do this thing so wonderfully always teach you to do that. And there are various ways of doing it. You can physically go to a balcony and breathe in fresh air and think about how you're going to handle such a situation. You can also go to somebody else. William Ury, since we're talking about William Ury, who's, in my view, is a hero and a real grandfather of this whole practice of mediation. He tells the story of the head of a family somewhere in the Middle East who owned camels. He owned so many camels that he didn't know what to do with them at the point that he died. So he wrote a will, and he had three sons, and he divided his herd of camels among his three sons. For various reasons, he gave half the camels in his herd to his eldest son, a third of his camels to his second oldest son, and a ninth of his camels to his third oldest son. Years later, he died, and the sons got the will, at the point that the herd consisted of 17 camels. And obviously, 17 doesn't divide by 2, it doesn't divide by 3, and it doesn't divide by 9. So they had an enormous fight, massive confrontation. And we all know that dividing inheritance is a massive source and a continuing and difficult source of confrontation and conflict in families, tearing them often apart. What did they do? They went to the balcony, these three sons. And the balcony in their case was a wise elder. A woman, actually. And the three of them went to the wise elder and said, and explained the situation. We've got 17 camels. It doesn't divide to enable the will, unless we kill all the camels. But the herd is there for camel milk. So if we kill the camels, we can eat the meat, but then you've got no income. The wise elder said, I've got a camel. Let me give you my camel. And they said, okay. And then they talked and they said, okay, now we've got 18 camels. 18 divides by 2 into 9 camels. It also divides by 3. And it also divides by 9. And the sum total of 9, 6, and 2 equals 17. They had one camel left over, and they gave it back to the wise elder. And everything was sorted. Isn't that clever?
That's great.
That's going to the balcony, folks.
You get the point. Yes. So we're all at 2 right now, and given the stretch, I'm going to call it a draw in terms of that. I have 2 more questions that I'll go to. We're going to unfortunately have to call it a draw in terms of the points. You end up with 2 here. And I'm going to close the panel with 2 more questions about some, I would say, hotly contested issues in the world of mediation. And the first one is about the plenary session and making a presentation. The other is going to be about disclosing, Harold, this is the bottom line, disclosing your bottom line to the mediator. So the first question is, again, going back to Hal Abramson's book, In Mediation Representation, maybe Harold, we can start with you on this. Professor Abramson says parties will almost always want to present opening statements because when they're done well, they can help set a positive tone, they cultivate a problem-solving environment, they frame key issues, they provide an opportunity to speak directly to the other side, they can give an emotional release, I've seen this myself many times, to the client that may be necessary to achieve resolution, and they can improve your understanding of the other side's perspective and evidence. He's speaking from a party's perspective. But he says, he notes, that there is a vocal group of mediators and advocates who think opening statements should not be used. I'm going to give you some of these, and you can name two of these that are objections, or just suggest, what are the two of the reasons? I've got multiple reasons, but what are two of the objections, he says, that people say you should not use opening statements? Harold, or?
What are two objections as to what?
Of the crowd that's opposed to opening statements.
What I've heard is that it just further polarizes the parties, and it also is a very, very risk fraud environment because it's difficult to control if there is an instance of mismanaged emotions. So it's just risky, and it tends to polarize. That's the chief objection.
That's actually one of the objections he cites. So, yep. Alex, any arguments against opening statements? Which I found surprising because I'm accustomed to always presenting them, but I found there were actually some pretty good reasons that were presented.
Well, I guess another one would be that there may be some disputes where it's actually unhelpful to one or more of the parties to coming to an agreement. And so it doesn't just hold the position neutral, it moves the negotiation backwards. It's a bit of a twist on polarization, but it may be that you
No, that was actually a separate reason. That was another reason he gave. He said that there's some, actually what he says, there's some cases where the mediators will say, that the lawyers say, you're just going to piss off my client. Mm-hmm. It's just going to make things worse if they come in. You know, my client doesn't want to pay you to come sit there and have somebody berate them for their behavior. Any other ideas about why people would think that you should not make opening statements?
I've experienced mediation as a party where there's been no opening statement, because no opening statement was necessary because the parties knew exactly where each other was coming from, at least formally. They'd already seen the argument.
That's literally what he says. He says parties, because the lawyers say the parties have heard it all already. This is just wasted time preparing, wasted money preparing, and wasted time at the mediation. I tell you, I walk away saying, in most instances, though, I think I'm probably going to still want to have the opening statements. Well, I mean, let me ask you, what do you think in terms of, my takeaway actually from this discussion was, and also here, is there's probably no one right way to do it.
Yeah, it depends. Yeah. That's the whole thing about what is mediation. It is negotiation. It is a branch of negotiation. In a normal negotiation, do you have opening statements? Hell no, normally not. So why would you do it in mediation as a default, invariable practice? I would say it's part of the skill of the mediator to decide whether it's necessary.
Well, as a mediation advocate primarily, I would always look for the opportunity, because it's one of the very few occasions when, as an advocate, you have unfettered access to the opposing decision maker. They're sitting there and they pretty much have to listen to what you've got to say. Now, if you're going to use that time, you aren't likely to make legal submissions because they won't be very effective. But it is a moment, a short moment, when they will pay attention and you can therefore try and persuade them. And so I always want to seize that opportunity if it's available. It may not be me doing the talking. Ideally, my clients would be talking and being their own negotiators, their own advocates. But I want the opportunity if it's available.
And Mike, could I comment on that? You know, I really believe that we should never, ever underestimate just how cathartic it can be for parties to have an opportunity to tell their story in their own way, if council will allow them to open up. You'd be amazed at how it can help to manage the emotional content that could be present at mediation. And I'm just always amazed when I hear this objection from counsel, and I say to myself, putting on my lawyer hat, if I were an advocate, why would I ever bypass this golden opportunity to really get a sense as to how this other party might appear if it moves on to an adjudicative setting, whether it be arbitration or litigation, or just to even get better insight in terms of what's the gravamen to this dispute that's driven the impasse that we're in. There's huge upside to opening statements. I agree with Michael, we have to use judgment, but all too often what you hear, chiefly from litigators, is they don't want to do opening statements simply because it's risky. But there's risk on one side of the equation, there can be absolutely huge upside on the other, especially including party engagement, getting the parties to do the heavy lifting at mediation.
Michael?
I think we're guilty of making a ridiculous mistake. William Ury's latest book is called Getting to Yes with Yourself and Other Worthy Opponents. And you know we're guilty of it right now. We have done nothing but discuss mediation in the context of disputes. Why? Why have we self-limited this amazing process and excluded it from deal-making just by virtue of the fact of concentrating on disputes? Are we that narrow? Are we that limited? Are we so driven that we can only think of it in that singular linear direction? We shouldn't do that. The future of mediation, I verily believe, is in deal making. The solution to a dispute is a deal. We call it with this ridiculous word settlement, but it's a deal. So, I mean, I've seen situations where I've actually used and published with disclosing the names of the parties, a case that I had, the situation I had, it wasn't a case. We were total friends. I wanted to sell a bunch of corporate assets to another company, and they wanted to buy. We had been long-time friends and partners and wished to remain so. There was no conceivable dispute or prospect thereof, but we couldn't agree on the price, the value of these assets. So we agreed to have a neutral person help us, a mediator. And that enabled us to come to a conclusion. Why are we limiting ourselves at all times, everywhere in the world, in my experience of working with IMI and prior to that, thinking of this in disputes? And I would say to the institutions and anybody who's a practitioner and a party, think of it more broadly, because that is where the value is.
You know, what Michael Orsay is also listening to the panel here, I would say also to think of it in terms of not always thinking of what the formula is, not doing what convention mandates. To hear that we should always give an opening statement, well, maybe we shouldn't always do that. I mean, we talk about international mediation, well, it's always one day or 2 days because you have people traveling. You know, if you have a mediation here in Italy, it's more like visits to a dentist. It's like once again, and no, you have multiple appointments. They're all rather short and painful. And then you kind of, over time, hopefully reach, but you follow the formula rather than what may be, maybe the best mediators or the best parties, the most sophisticated, the advice would be adapt the process to the dispute itself. Don't do it just because that's how it's always
absolutely
done.
Yeah, absolutely.
Absolutely right.
That flexibility. Last question, by the way, and then I'm going to ask you all, we're going to end up here, but I'm going to ask you all after this last question to close by making your prediction for what to expect from Florence and the FIMC 5 years down the road. What should we expect here to take place 5 years after the launch of the Florence International Mediation Chamber? But no, last question is about disclosing the bottom line. In their book, Success as a Mediator for Dummies, This book actually exists. It's actually one of the Dummies series by Victoria Pynchon and Joseph Krainic. They mention there's a lot of discussion about whether parties should disclose their true bottom lines to the mediator. What do they recommend? A, always disclose your bottom line to the mediator during the private caucus sessions. B, never disclose your bottom line to the mediator. Or C, only reveal your true bottom line to the mediator when the parties have reached an impasse in the negotiations. So A is always, B is never, and C, only to overcome an impasse. What do they answer in success? Success as a mediator for dummies. Any guesses?
Well, I would do it on the basis of my level of trust and confidence in the mediator.
But what do they recommend? What
they
do you think?
Probably recommend C, impasse, only at impasse.
You think they recommend?
No, I should think they recommend A.
A always.
So spell it.
Yeah, I would hope to have such a trust in the mediator that I would do it.
Interestingly enough here, the answer was B.
Well, then you shouldn't buy the book.
What they say is that you should. The mediator should. They say the mediator, this is their recommendation. The mediator should tell the parties that you don't even want to know what their real bottom line is, because if you do, you may inadvertently reveal the information to the other side, and that will potentially compromise the perception of reality. Of neutrality that you have in dealing with them.
Yeah, but that assumes the mediator is incompetent. That assumes incompetency on the part of the mediator.
It assumes incompetency on the part of the mediator.
It assumes incompetency on the part of the average mediator. That's a terrible indictment of mediation. Terrible.
I agree there.
I'm going to buy that book and then burn it.
Anybody else?
I heard, again, a very, very esteemed litigation counsel say something at a presentation and I thought was really illuminating. And his admonition to counsel, mediation advocates, was make your mediator earn your trust. Make your mediator earn your trust. So he says when he hasn't worked with a mediator before, he's going to really hold back. And when he determines that he can trust that mediator, only then will he start to really allow more insight in terms of the most confidential aspects of the case, including a bottom line, but not
comment,
before trusting
him. Let's get a response from Ben. Ben actually says he tells parties he doesn't want to know. Because they will tell each other at the appropriate time. That's Ben's technique. It will change, because it will change in time. It will change in time when they listen to each other.
Well, I think the biggest issue is that you can't always, even if you start the mediation thinking you know what your client's bottom line is, in fact you may not, because they may well not have told you for cultural reasons or because they've just changed their mind in the course of the process. So, as an advocate and representative, you've got to be alive to that possibility.
I would say never, ever fence with a competent mediator. Never. It's a recipe for total disaster.
Yeah. And on
I
that,
agree with that,
do you have any questions? I'll have time for one question. If not, it's an awkward room to have questions anyway. Why don't we close? We'll start with Alex. Florence International Mediation Center here in Florence. 5 years down the road, your predictions.
My aspiration, whether it's a prediction, is that corporates all across at least northern Italy and maybe the whole country are seeking this place out as a venue to come and resolve their conflict. And I would like continental Europe to be looking in this direction for guidance as to the way to go forward.
Spela.
Well, you put me in a tricky position, me and Harold, I guess. what I would hope for the International Florence International Mediation Chamber is that they would spread the culture of mediation further on, and hopefully, you know, the other events that are coming, such as the Global Pound Conference, which I hear will also be hosted here, would help this purpose. And what I would also hope that they would promote the equality also between men and women, which you will see. I would say it's sometimes a bit of a challenge. And let me just conclude. I mean, I'm sorry, I'm a woman, I cannot get over it, but obviously the wise woman in Michael's story, I'm sorry, the wise person, the wise elderly in the Michael story was a woman. So just don't forget that, the Florence International Mediation Chamber.
Harold?
I would say that Florence would really be the genesis of other chambers and other institutions across Italy, having looked at this model and replicated and have some fully competent and, again, circumspect mediators using the IMI standards to really cause mediation to expand and be utilized in its best form all across Italy and, indeed, other EU nations.
Michael?
I get the last say, which is how I prefer to have it, by the way. Life throws up three options to all of us, and all three are viable, and you can choose which according to the circumstances. And those three options are: you can lead, you can follow, or you can get out of the way. What has happened here, it started in Singapore, and I've been immensely privileged to be a component part of the development there, is a fine act of leadership. What has happened here is partly leadership and partly following. This is leadership within Europe, and I don't just mean Italy, hugely significant though that is. But it is following a proven, inspirational example, and you know what? Others will follow what Florence is doing. I predict, you asked for a prediction, not a hope, not an aspiration. I predict 20,000 cases between now and 5 years' time will be resolved in one way or another with this axis in place, provided one thing. Because leadership doesn't just happen, you gotta work on it hard. And I sense, I've been in Singapore many times and I've taken in the inspiration that I've got from here, from the Florence Chamber and the Chamber of Mediation and the Chamber of Commerce. And there is desire and indeed even fire. And it will work. You will make it work, because if you don't, you are missing massive opportunity. And you will find people from anywhere in the world, South America, North America, the subcontinent, Australasia, throughout Asia, you will find people inspired by this, and they'll be coming. There's no nexus to Italy or indeed perhaps even Asia. They'll want to come because they see this works. Promote it, explain it, be brilliant about it. Use the best technology because you're leading. And the rest will follow, and those that are not clever enough to understand it will just simply get out of the way, and that's fine too. So I wish that happens, but I also predict, knowing the people, that it will happen. And I thank you very much for that.
Thank you. Thank you all for, and hopefully all of these predictions will come true in 5 years. You will be back here to see them have come true. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed to all the panelists of this second discussion. Now we are nearly at the end. We have the closing speech by the general manager of the Florence Chamber of Commerce, Mrs. Laura Benedetto.
Saremo velocissimi visto l'orario tardo e l'orario del pranzo. Allora, una rapidissima, intanto io ringrazio tutti coloro, gli ospiti nazionali ed internazionali che hanno partecipato. Io chiudo, mi ero preparato un discorso ma non lo faccio perché come al solito funziona così, gli spunti migliori si hanno sentendo le persone. Questa mattina abbiamo sentito tantissime cose interessanti, mi è piaciuto però quello che ha detto in modo particolare Bennett Picker. Lui ha detto che la negoziazione è un'opportunità e infatti è così, è un'opportunità per le imprese, è un'opportunità per i cittadini, è un'opportunità per gli avvocati, infatti anche per i professionisti. E io ci terrei moltissimo che i professionisti, in modo particolare fiorentini, italiani, entrassero in maniera, diciamo così, pesante in questo settore della mediazione. Quindi noi come Camera di Commercio mettiamo a disposizione tutta la nostra struttura. Abbiamo creato il Florence International Mediation Chamber e speriamo che soprattutto con il vostro aiuto e con le vostre idee possa veramente diventare un punto di riferimento nel mondo. Voglio salutare tutti gli ospiti stranieri che sono stati gentilissimi, squisiti a venire qui. E in modo particolare però permettetemi un ringraziamento particolare a Michael McEwart, che ha un cognome impronunciabile, che per noi è stato prezioso in tutta questa organizzazione. E la mia dirigente, Brunella Tarli, che ci ha messo il cuore in questa, per l'organizzazione di questa giornata. Grazie a tutti e speriamo di vederci prestissimo.